This is the first of several videos on the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus. Now, the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus relates three different things. In this video, we're going to talk about what they are, and in the next video, we're going to start developing the Fundamental Theorem. So the first thing is the definite integral. The definite integral is the amount of stuff between A and B, and we're going to go into more detail on that. And the thing about this is it's a number. It's not a function, it's a number. The integral from 1 to 3 of 3x squared dx is 26. That's a number. The second thing is what we're calling an integral function. This is a running total. It's the total amount of stuff from A to x. And the third thing is an antiderivative, a function whose derivative is little f of x. Now, there are two versions of the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus. The one that's used the most often is actually called the second Fundamental Theorem of Calculus, and it relates definite integrals to antiderivatives. It gives a wonderful recipe for how to actually compute a definite integral by finding an antiderivative. The other half of the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus, sometimes called the first Fundamental Theorem of Calculus, relates the integral function to an antiderivative. It says that the integral function is an antiderivative. So let's take a look at what these quantities are. So the definite integral is the amount of stuff between A and B. Now, what do we mean by stuff? Well, the classic example is area under a curve. So in this case, this integral would give you this much area. Now that's a number. There's a certain amount of area between A and B. Another example is distance. Suppose that you integrate velocity. Then the integral of velocity with respect to time is the distance you traveled. If you integrate from 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock, it's how far you went between 1 o'clock and 4 o'clock. That's a number. If you integrate from 2 o'clock to 3 o'clock, you'll get a different number. Now, definite integrals are also limits, because the way that we do these integrals is by chopping into pieces. If we want to figure out what is the area under the curve between A and B, we take the region and we slice it onto a whole bunch of pieces that are supposed to be all the same width. We slice it into n pieces, and you say the whole area is the area of the first piece plus the area of the second piece plus the area of the third piece. You have to add up the areas of all the different slices, and then you say, well, what's the area of a slice? Well, the area of the slice is the width of the slice, that's delta x, times the height of the slice, except that's not quite right. It would be the width times the height if we had a rectangle, but we don't have a rectangle. We have some other shape. It's close to a rectangle. It's a little bit bigger than this rectangle. It's a little bit smaller than that rectangle. So we can approximate it by taking the area of the rectangle. And then we add them all up, and we say, well, what's the height of the rectangle? The height of the rectangle is the value of the function at some point, which we call xi star. So x1 star might be somewhere in here, x2 star might be somewhere in here, x3 star might be somewhere in here, and we add them up. And if we want to get more and more and more accurate, we want to take more and more and more pieces, so the actual integral is the limit of a sum. So this is the definition of a definite integral. All the business about area under a curve or distance traveled, those are important examples, but this is the definition. Now this is hard. For most functions, you don't really want to chop things up into pieces and add them up and take a limit. That's a lot of work. Now, An integral function, as we said, is the running total. I could take the area between a and b, and that would be the integral from a to b of f of s ds. Now notice I'm calling the variable s, because I want x to be some particular value of s. So if we want this area, how much area do you have up to x? That's going to be the integral from a to x of f of s ds. And we'll give this a name. We'll call it I of x. So I of x gives you the area up to x. If I give you a different value of x, let's call this x1 and x2. I of x1 is this much area. I of x2 is this much area. I of b is all of this area. So this is the same as a definite integral, only we're expressing it as a function of the endpoint. Instead of being a fixed total, it's a running total. You could do the same thing for our velocity problem. If we call this I of t, that's going to be the integral from 1 to t. So it's the distance traveled starting at 1 o'clock and ending at time t. Okay, last concept, antiderivative. An antiderivative is just a function whose derivative is little f. So if the derivative of big F is little f, we say little f is the derivative of big F, and big F is the antiderivative of little f. But I should be careful about when we say the. We tend to say the a lot, although it's actually inaccurate. Because what's the antiderivative of 3x squared? Well, you might say x cubed, because the derivative of x cubed is 3x squared. Or you might say x cubed plus 7, since the derivative of x cubed plus 7 is also 3x squared. Or you could say x cubed plus any constant. Really, we should say an antiderivative. X cubed is an antiderivative. X cubed plus 7 is a different antiderivative. X cubed plus any constant is yet another antiderivative. And that's it. Those are the three concepts. In the next video, we'll start to relate them.